Praise God, brethren. It's a wonderful Sunday morning and welcome to Dominion Church International Mbeya. At Dominion Church, we are a ministry that is committed to the word, worship and witness, and we are very delighted that you have chosen to fellowship with us today. My name is Margaret Musoke and I'll be taking you through our weekly programs. Every Sunday, just like today, from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m., we do have our Sunday service. And on Tuesdays, we do have the Bible study with Pastor John Mbazira, starting from 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. And on Fridays, we are live during the lunch hour service from 1 p.m. to 2 p.m. with our pastors. They are here praying for you. We are worshiping together. You can send in your prayer request because it is live. And they will get back to you anytime. Now, do not forget to give. We are still giving, even though the church is closed for now. Our offices are open and you can always bring in your tithes and offerings and any other support to the church, to our offices. And if you cannot come here physically, we do have the mobile money numbers just below on the screen. You can send in your tithes, offerings, and any support to the church, and we shall be grateful. God will bless you. Now, it is time to get up wherever you are, whether in your sitting room, in your bedroom, collect your family, gather your friends, and let us get ready for worship as we welcome the Dominion Praise Ministries. Always remember, we do love you so much, and please enjoy your service.
Lift up your heads, all ye gates, that the King of Glory may come in. And who is the King of Glory? The Lord strong. Church, all of you from all over the world. Good morning, Dominion Church. Good afternoon, world. Good evening, world.
Yeah.
chuka na yeye tachuka. Yekatonda tawe wachisanja. Ye yari ari erariba. Sharande satalaba ya tayararera.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yesu Kristo. Tajurukuka Yesu Kristo Tajurukuka Tajurukuka Emirembe jona Yesu Kristo Hallelujah.
Praise, we give you glory.
Hallelujah. Tukuwe tendo, tukuwe chitiwa.
There is none like you, King of Glory. We thank you for this moment, Lord. And for today's word. We get into the gospel according to Mark chapter 8. We'll be taking it from verse 34 to verse 38. The Bible says that when he called the people to himself with his disciples also, He said to them, whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake, and the Gospels will save it. For what will it profit a man when he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him the Son of Man also will be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Brethren, this morning we have an invitation. It is an invitation to follow the Lord. We saw him in the book of Matthew chapter 1 and verse 17. When he met the first disciples. The Bible has this account. He tells them, come, follow me. And I will make you fishers of men. It is an invitation that has come down through the ages of men of every rank and file, people of every language and tribe, people of every estate in life. Jesus is no respecter of persons. It is still the same invitation. Come. Follow me. It is amazing in the time that we live in. People have different perspectives of life. We view life differently. And often we take the path of life based on how we view it. Some people view life as a marketplace. It is a place to trade. It is a place of exchange. And at the end of life, their question is, did I make a profit or did I make a loss? Other people look at life as a competition. To them, it is occupying positions. They grow up competing against each other. They get to school and it is a gesturing for positions. Often, if their talents, if their abilities don't get them what they want, then they use underhand methods to be able to achieve the positions they want. As a result, they end up cheating. As a result, they end up bribing. As a result, they end up in witchcraft to try to get those who seem to be better off to get behind them. They try everything to be at the very top. Sometimes it doesn't happen. But you ask yourself a question. Now that you have been at the top, at the end of your life, so what? Is that all there is? Some look at life as a battlefield. It is about fighting. It is war.
Ndutalo.
They grow up believing that they are combatants.
Bakulanga bamanyi tibalina okubanti balwanyi.
They face life with a combative spirit.
Banganga obulamu n'omwoyo gw'obulwanyi.
Everything about them.
Nga buli kyonna ekibeetolodde.
Is warrior-like.
Nga byakulwana.
They look at everyone as their enemy.
Batunuulira buli muntu yenna ng'omulabe waabwe.
Everything about them.
Buli kyonna ekibakwatako.
Is to be able to struggle and fight.
Kusobola kulwana kuwakana
kutawo. Even when they get to family.
Never but come family.
They fight everyone.
Balwanyisa buli muntu
yenna. If their wives, they fight their husbands.
Bwe baba abakyala balwanyisa
abaami. If their husbands, they fight their wives.
Bwe balera abaami balwanyisa abakyala.
They fight their children.
Balwanyisa abaana.
They fight their employees.
Balwanyisa bakozesa.
They are fighting everywhere.
Balwanyisa buli muntu yenna.
Even when they come to church.
Never bajja mu kanisa wewunye.
When you give them a task.
Boba wa omulimu.
If it is to sing,
oba kuyimba,
they bring war songs.
Balete nyimba izo za kulwana.
If it is to pray,
bekuwa kusaba,
it is prayer concerning war.
Esara yawe ebera ya lutalo.
Everything about them is waging war.
Bibe bya lutalo kutandika lutalo kulwana.
So the question at the end of life,
kati ekibuzo ku nkomere y'obulamu,
they will be asking themselves,
bajja kuba bebuza,
did I win?
Na wangula?
Or did I lose? So if you lost, so what? If you won, so what? You see, we need to begin to look at life from an eternal perspective. Sometimes people look at life from an angle of expectation. It is about achieving goals, about achieving dreams. As much as that is ideal, there is no ceiling to what you and I can achieve in life. So back to the end of life. What will you have achieved? And many leave this world very disappointed. Because they did not achieve everything they thought they would achieve. Yet in fact, it is their perspective about life that is bringing them to this point. Some are dramatic. They look at life as drama. So their whole life is either a comedy. Even when they do something, they'll say, is it funny? So they are looking out for a comedian kind of life. All a thriller kind of life. All an action-packed kind of life.
All
a horror. Because some people are interested in horrors. But at the end of the day, should your life be just a movie? Everything you have, every ability you have, should it be just a movie? Should it be just a joke? It is against this background that Jesus comes to us with an invitation. You who has the perception of the war mentality. You has the perception of expectation. You has the perception of competition. His is a simple invitation. Come. Follow me. Now this calls for you obeying something. Because this is not a one-time thing. The invitation to follow is in the present continuous tense. It starts the moment you say yes to Jesus and goes on into eternity. It is a journey where competition should not come in the picture. Because in competition, people end up biting ears. People end up tripping each other. In competition, people are devising ways of making shortcuts in life. That's not what he wants for your life. He says, you come. I want you to follow me. Come. There is a path he's leading you. It is a path you have not taken before. That is why he says, follow me. Now, if you have the competitive spirit, you want to be in the first position. Many times we end up running ahead of ourselves, only to look back, and the one who is supposed to lead us, we have left behind. The Bible tells us of an account in the book of 2 Samuel, chapter 18. It narrates a story of a man called
Ahimaaz.
Ahimaaz comes to the forefront at the time when
Absalom
has rebelled against his father. And in the battle that ensues, Joab, who is leading David's soldiers, overcomes the army that Absalom has set against his father. And in the following pursuit, Absalom is killed. Now
Ahimaaz
turns to Joab and says, let me take the news to David. David turns to him and says, not today. You shall not take the news today. Ahimaaz insists and says, please, let me go. So Joab turns to the Cushite who is next to him and tells the Cushite, you shall take the news. Go tell the king everything you have seen. And Ahimaaz keeps pleading until finally Joab tells him, okay, you go. And Ahimaaz runs so fast. He takes the road to the plain. And he overtakes the Cushite. Now David is seated by the gate. He sees one person, they see one person coming. And so he says, that looks like
Ahimaaz.
He should be bringing good news. And Ahimaaz comes in, stands before David. And David asks him, what happened? He tells him, glory be to God. He's given you victory over your enemies. And David asks, what about the young man? And Ahimaaz stammers.
He
says, yes, there was Joab, there was a tumult, but I did not see everything. And David tells him, step aside. He is a messenger without a message. Why? Because he believes in competition. If this news must be delivered, it has to be me to deliver. And at the end of the day, he had nothing to give to the king. And they tell David, come, there is another one.
And
the Cushite comes in. And he delivers the message. And David asks, what about the young man? And he tells him the young man was killed. What is the point? You see, it is not because you can outrun everybody that you should be the one to carry the message. The race is not the swift. The battle is not the strong. The invitation God is calling us to, the invitation Jesus is calling us to, is an invitation to follow him. It is not an invitation to outrun one another. Every one of us has a race to run. Your race cannot be my race. Everyone, the Bible tells us, we have a race set before us. And we should run this race looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and he sat down at the right hand of the God Almighty. And the Bible says, consider him who endured such affliction from sinners against himself, lest you grow weary and faint in your soul. This journey is a journey where the one leading us has been there before. And in this text, he prepares us for what we need to carry along the way, and what we need to have as an attitude if we are to be successful on this journey. And the Bible therefore tells us, whoever desires to come after me, he gives us the attitude that we should have. He should deny himself. You have to come to a point where the world is dead to you, and you are dead to the world. There are certain things you will deny yourself. You see, the world has painted a perception that the way to life is to deny yourself nothing. Jesus says the opposite. He says you will deny yourself, and then he gives us the equipment for the journey. The equipment you need is the cross, and he says carry your cross and follow me. Now that does not look appealing to them. But if we are to be successful on this journey, we have got to yield. It takes us to yield to what he is saying. Yes, it may not look appealing. Yes, it may look foolishness to those around us. Yes, it may not trend with the times. But he who has called us is faithful. He will not allow us to drop along the way. He says, come, follow me. That means on this journey, there will be moments where he will say stop, and nothing seems to be moving. That's a moment we don't like, because we are people interested in motion. We associate motion with progress. But there will be moments in this journey where he will say stop, and like you move on a journey and you meet a stoplight, the expectation is that you stop at that moment. So what is stop in the spiritual thing? It is the word patience, where he says wait, not now. Many of us don't want that. We want to keep moving. We want to go on. We want to soldier on. But the Bible tells us in the book of Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, the scripture we know very well. The scripture says that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. The period of waiting is a moment of re-energizing. It is a moment of refocusing. It is a moment when we align to the purposes of God. It is a moment of strengthening. And yet many of us don't want to hear the word stop. We interpret stop to mean slow down. Slow down and stop are two different things. One does not substitute for each other. If you don't believe me, ask someone to beat you and tell them slow down. And then tell them stop. Then you will know the difference. The two are not the same. Secondly, on this journey, it is an invitation to everyone as an individual. He is not inviting the whole congregation. You see, we want to move in masses. But he says, if anyone, he doesn't say if everybody, anyone, uno, one, you come as an individual. It is a response you make as one man, as one woman, and say, here I come. I'm coming to do your will, O God. I have come just as I am. I have come with my cross. The cross represents crucifixion. It is a surrender to life, that it may be fulfilled what Paul writes in Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20, that I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave up himself for me. Does that represent who you are? If not, Jesus is inviting you to a journey. Today we have so many people who love following. We have virtual followings on Facebook and Twitter. But it is time for you and I to follow Jesus. Make that decision as an individual. Because if that does not happen, you will win everything on this side of time. And lose your soul in eternity. And therefore Jesus asks, what will it profit a man having gained everything on this side of eternity, yet loses his soul? Saints and friends of God, if you are listening to me and watching me right now and have never received Jesus in your life, the invitation begins with you saying yes. Today, you can follow Jesus. Today, you can accept him in your life and make him your personal Lord and Savior. If you have never done that, make this prayer with me. Say, God Almighty, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for the gift of salvation. Salvation which is by faith through Jesus Christ. Today, I receive you, Jesus, in my life as my personal Lord and Savior. Today, I decide to embark on this journey, following you, Lord Jesus, as my Lord and the Savior of my life. Wash me, Lord. Forgive me, Lord. Fill me with your Spirit and empower me for this journey. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Amen.
Amen.
If you made that prayer, you have been wonderfully saved. For those of you that are burdened, Jesus makes the same invitation. He says, come unto me, all of you that are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Today, whatever your burden
is,
Jesus desires, wills for your life that you surrender it to him. If you can only say, Lord, here it is. Whatever the burden, burdens of sickness, burdens of debt, loads of depression, surrender it all to him right now and ask him to take it and provide freedom and deliverance and peace in its place. Thank you, Lord. We give you praise, we give you glory. Now for you, who has a gift to give, there is a number on your screen. Please send through that gift to advance God's kingdom. And God richly bless you as you do that. From Dominion Church, till we meet again, we say shalom. God richly bless you. Amen.
Amen.